Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. We're delighted to have you either in church or on Zoom for the children's service offered by Christ Episcopal Church here in Los Altos, California. Glory to God forever and ever. So this morning we are without our usual choir since we had such a busy last week of December, but we'll sing the same basic song that we sang throughout Advent, but with our Christmas word. So it's, He came down that we may have peace. So if you'd like to join the hand motions, they go like this. And I'll sing it all the way through once, and then if you'd like to join me the second time I sing it through, you're welcome to. He came down that we may have peace. He came down that we may have peace. He came down that we may have peace. Alleluia forevermore. He came down that we may have peace. He came. Later this morning in our 10:15 service, we are going to continue hearing part of the Christmas story through the Gospel of Matthew. So there is a lot that's just a little different between the Matthew story and the Luke story when it comes to the Christmas telling of the birth of Jesus. One thing that is definitely different is the role of the angels. So many of us are familiar with the story that Luke's gospel tells us about angels. An angel comes to Mary, of course, Angel Gabriel, to tell her that she is going to bear a son. And Mary asks all the questions we hear in the Christmas pageant, how can this be, since I have no husband? And then finally she agrees to bear God's life in the world through her son, Jesus. Also in Luke's gospel, the angels come to the shepherds tending their flock in the field and tell them that the child has been born and that they'll find him lying in a manger. Neither of these two things happen in Matthew's gospel, but there are several appearances of an angel. And that angel comes not to Mary, not to the shepherds, but four times in the first two chapters of Matthew's gospel to Joseph. First, the angel comes and tells Joseph in a dream that Mary is pregnant, but he should stay with her. He should walk this path with her. Something more than he can imagine will come from it. This morning, an angel comes to Joseph after they're in Bethlehem and says, "Get up, flee to Egypt. You are not safe. Herod is afraid of this baby, and he's coming, and he's going to cause him harm." So Joseph gets up, and he leaves. Many years later, living in Egypt, the angel comes to Joseph again in a dream and says, "Herod is dead. You can go home now. You can go back to Israel." So he goes. But as they're journeying back home, the angel comes a fourth time and says to him, "Herod's son is now ruling over the area where you used to live. It's still not safe for you there. Go to Nazareth and make your life, start your new life in this new place where you'll be safe." So four times this angel comes to Joseph with guidance, with information, telling him what to do next. I have to imagine, when I think about these four instances, that almost none of them, none of the announcements of the angel, were particularly welcome. They all came with a really hard ask of Joseph. First, stay with Mary. Marry her even though she's having a child that isn't yours. Then get up, flee in the middle of the night. Nobody wants to be woken in the middle of the night to run away. Finally, they've made a life in Egypt, and the angel comes back and says, "Nope, this isn't where you're going to plant yourself. Go somewhere else." Over and over again, the angel comes with these hard, hard lessons. But the angel's words also carry some themes. The angel is always guiding Joseph with how to care for those around him, to care for those who depend on him, specifically Mary and Joseph. The angel is always coming, trying to keep him safe, trying to help him to do what is going to protect himself and those around him. And the angel is always, of course, coming bearing God's good guidance and God's good news. So all of this makes me think about the angels in our own lives, in our own paths, our own journeys, the angels who come to us maybe with hard, maybe unwelcome news that is often ultimately from God, maybe difficult asks, difficult invitations, the call to risk something new, something big, for something good, the call to care for our neighbors and those close to us when it costs us something, when it is difficult, those who are trying to keep us safe, help us learning and growing. I invite you to take a minute and think about the angels in your own life. May we stay open this day and in the days to come for God's visitations, for God. Amen.
Okay, now it's time for our closing prayer. You know what we're going to do? We're going to wake up our hands, all warmed up and everything. It's a chilly morning. Put them over our heart. Try and relax for just a moment. Take a deep breath. We don't want to hurry. Gracious God, we know you are all around us because we are surrounded by a host of angels. Angels you have sent to give us the news as you did to Joseph. Help us to remember to listen, and to listen hard sometimes. The news which we may not really think we need. Heed your call every day. Help us to be angels for others too, when you call us to do that. For all of this, we know you will bless us in. We bless you. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Well, that concludes our children's. And we hope you'll stay. The prelude will start shortly.
Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who wonderfully created and yet more wonderfully restored the dignity of human nature, grant that we may share the divine life of him who humbled himself to share our humanity, your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, sing aloud with gladness for Jacob and raise shouts for the chief of the nations. Proclaim, give praise and say, save, O Lord, your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I am going to bring them from the land of the north, and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth, among them the blind and the lame, those with child and those in labor, together, a great company, they shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with consolations I will lead them back. I will let them walk by brooks of water, in a straight path in which they shall not stumble. For I have become a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Hear the words of the Lord, O nations, and declare it in the coastlands far away. Say, he who scattered Israel will gather him and will keep him as a shepherd of flock. For the Lord has ransomed Jacob and has redeemed him from hands too strong for him. They shall come and sing aloud on the height of Zion, and they shall be radiant over the goodness of the Lord, over the grain, the wine, and the oil, and over the young of the flock and the herd. Their life shall become like a watered garden, and they shall never languish again. Then shall the young women rejoice in the dance, and the young men and the old shall be merry. I will turn their mourning into joy. I will comfort them and give them gladness for sorrow. I will give the priests their fill of fatness, and my people shall be satisfied with my bounty, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The psalm appointed for today is a portion of Psalm 84. I invite you to pray with me. The psalm is printed in the bulletin. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts. My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God. The sparrow has found her a house, and the swallow a nest where she may lay her young. By the side of your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you. Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way. Those who go through the desolate valley will find it a place of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water. They will climb from height to height, and the God of gods will reveal himself in Zion. Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Hearken, O God of Jacob. Behold our defender, O God, and look upon the face of your anointed.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in God before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. When the wise men who had come from the east had departed, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who are seeking the child's life are dead." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled: "He will be called a Nazarene." The Gospel of the Lord. May I speak in the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God. Amen. You may be seated. Limited opportunities for fellowship and gatherings, or maybe it's because of a cascade of family crises that have beset those I love most over the last 2 years, and my growing tired of the same old and familiar troubles and tendencies. Or maybe this is just what it's like to be 37. I don't know. It's my first time to this particular party. But anyway, last October, as my final days as a 36-year-old neared, I heard that Brandi Carlile was playing at Frost Amphitheater as part of Stanford Live, and I texted my sister without a hint of subtlety and asked if she'd like to take me to a concert for my birthday. Thankfully, she did, so she bought tickets and we made plans. We rode our bikes lazily to Stanford from the rectory, like 13-year-olds, an utter delight. I hadn't been to a concert since the pandemic started, and hadn't been to a non-classical concert in probably over a decade. It was wonderful. But there was this one moment in the middle of the evening that gave me pause. After the opening act concluded, well after the sun had set and the mosquitoes had announced their presence, I put my shoes on and excused myself to go to the restroom. While washing my hands, I heard Brandi take the stage and began to walk back just as the stadium lights went out and the stage lights went on. I'd left my phone, my license, my socks with my sister somewhere in a suddenly indiscernible mass of people. Breathe, I told myself. Think, I told myself, scanning the rows of people gently sloping downward before me. I recalled that one very bright bank of lights had been just to our left, but as I stumbled along the sidewalk to the exterior aisle, the path beneath me entirely indiscernible, I felt my panic rise. How far in had we been seated? How far from the lights, really? What angle? What distance? Every time the stage lights shone bright, I tried to focus especially hard. Where was that familiar braid, or anyone seated nearby that I might recognize? I stood on the side for a few minutes, staring. Would Lauren get worried and come try to find me? How would we find each other then? I knew I wasn't thinking clearly, but not being able to orient in the darkness was genuinely alarming. I realized quite suddenly that while I've stepped outside after sunset, have walked home from the church at night, have even been camping in the not-too-distant past, it had been a long, long time since I was in that kind of darkness without a phone or a flashlight to illumine my way. I looked up at the stars, no moon that night, and didn't feel held and safe like I usually did. I felt small and lost and scared. Eventually, I went for it and jumped into the rows, trying to avoid the legs and sandwiches and open beers of my fellow concertgoers. I hunched down once in the fray. Did that light panel to my left look right? Was this the angle I'd been viewing the stage from? She had the bicycle lock key, my jacket, my water bottle. I'd left it all behind. This was supposed to be fun, I thought to myself. When finally I saw the back of her head a few rows up, a familiar sway, those hands, I all but leapt in her direction, eyes fixed on her back so as not to lose her, and plopped into my seat on the grass to her right. She's great, Lauren yelled, pointing to the stage, totally oblivious that the extra minutes it had taken me to get back to her had lasted, for me, an eternity. Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt. Today's gospel begins in the dark, that deep, impenetrable darkness, where answers and clarity and certainty and confidence have all slipped away. A darkness much more sinister and disorienting than I'd experienced at that concert. An angel comes to Joseph in a dream, for the second time in just these first two chapters of Matthew's gospel, the first being soon after he learned of Mary's pregnancy, when the angel told him he should stand by her. So he finds himself in that shadow land between sleep and waking with a familiar voice ringing in his ears. Get up, Joseph. Get up. What the angel knew that he did not yet was that Herod, frustrated that the wise men had not yet returned to him, had ordered the murder of all the children two and under in and around Bethlehem. Surely they left more than jackets and water bottles and bicycle keys behind. In this version of the Christmas story, they were in a house, not a manger, and whatever hospitality had been extended to this holy family ends abruptly with this warning.
They're driven even further south, feet sore, hearts heavy, their familiar lives receding even further into the distance. They manage to escape the bloodbath, and for years, scholars estimate at least 3.5 years, they make a life in this new, strange, and unfamiliar country. While there were likely some Jews living in Egypt at the time, they would have been a definite minority. In all likelihood, Joseph and Mary found themselves, like so many vulnerable immigrants in the world today, in a new place with a young child to care for. They didn't speak the language, didn't know the culture, didn't have jobs, didn't have papers, didn't plan to stay. But they couldn't go back, not yet, not without a sign, a word, a visitation. I can't help but wonder who opened the doors of the inns in Egypt to them, or sent them to the manger, or to the factory to find work, or to the fields to pick strawberries. What shelters they frequented, what nonprofits had the best free lunch, which clinics would see them without insurance, where the best places to pitch a tent under the freeway were, what school would take Jesus without a permanent address, which houses of worship made an effort to offer them refuge and respite, and just as importantly, kindness and respect. Eventually, after all those years of working and watching and waiting and wandering, they slept one long dark night, and the angel returned. "Get up," the voice says again, so familiar, yet so late, so long awaited. "Get up," the angel says. Herod has died, and it is now safe for them to return to the land of Israel, but not home. Never again do they get to go back to the home they once knew. Could Mary and Joseph have imagined all those many years before, when they left their lives behind for just a few days to travel to Bethlehem and register for the census, that they would never get to return? The successor to Herod was ruling over their region of Judea, and the angel comes a fourth time as they journey north to warn Joseph not to settle there. So it is that they find their way to Nazareth, an out-of-the-way town, a backwater, to begin all over again. The story tells us so much about Mary and Joseph, about God, how much it cost them all to bring this new life into the world, how often angels and angels in disguise must have intervened to keep them safe and warm and fed, how often terror and death attended Jesus' life, even as a child. This promised Savior, this eternal Christ, born in the flesh of a small child, his life was always imperiled, always subject to fear and loss and instability, not only at the end when Rome finally caught up with him, but all along. The birth of Christ, which we have waited so long to welcome into our world, our hearts, our homes, will eventually bring peace and joy, hope and wholeness. But often it first brings change, uncertainty, discomfort, seemingly unanswerable questions, as it did for Joseph and Mary. And as a result, the presence of God in our world generally ignites resistance. Those invested in the way things once were, the way things have always been, those invested in the lines already on the maps, or the lines that divide class and caste, or the lines that divide us and them, they will try to destroy this promised gift, to kill this child. The world has always mounted a defense against God's interruptions, God's divine interventions, out of a deadening preference for the status quo. As the saying goes, most people will choose a familiar misery over an unfamiliar joy, time and time again. Melissa Flora Bixler is a Mennonite pastor in North Carolina and the author of two wonderful books on Christian faith and practice. In a 2019 article that graced the cover of Sojourners magazine, she explored the concept of loving our enemies, so at the heart of the gospel, by arguing that this discipline starts with admitting that we have enemies, because Jesus had enemies. To love those who act in ways contrary to the life of God in this world, we have to be willing to name that such things exist, that there are actions, decisions, words, proclamations, laws, choices, habits, and a whole lot more that usher in and augment the movements of grace amongst us and those that do not. To name that someone is an enemy of God is not to say that they're irredeemable, that they will always be this. It's simply to acknowledge that they're not acting in accordance with God's ways. Flora Bixler noted that most people in her parish, educated, thoughtful, engaged adults, seem to think that having an enemy is a kind of moral failure. They, like we, are also inundated with messages that people are doing their best, but are also caught up in systems so much bigger than we are, and so we pass responsibility and blame for societal ills onto systemic oppression and political corruption, and try to wash our hands of one another's complicity and our own. But this is not at all consistent with the Bible. Christians follow scriptures in which enemies are named with clarity and vigor, Flora Bixler notes. From Emperor Tiberius and Herod to Judas and Pontius Pilate, the Gospels are not shy about naming the enemies of God, and neither was Jesus. Remember him calling the scribes and the Pharisees hypocrites? Remember him overturning the tables of the money changers in the temple? We might say that he was angry, emotional, passionate, but he was also modeling what he hoped his disciples would do. He was practicing love by refusing to conspire with the lies these people told themselves about each other and about the world, by refusing to pretend that what they were doing was anything but wrong, by holding up a mirror, by swiftly moving from critique to invitation into something else, attended always by demonstrations of healing and exorcism, promises of freedom. This morning's gospel is clear. Herod was an enemy of the good news of God revealed in Christ. And so were the people who failed to provide the Holy Family shelter and protection as they journeyed to Bethlehem and into Egypt. So was everyone who made their time in these places degrading and despairing. And so are we, any time we do the same to the strangers in our midst. Ultimately, the Christian discipline of loving our enemies is one of self-compassion, because we have all, in ways small and spectacular, failed to welcome God when God appeared, uninvited, unexpected, unrecognizable, as someone poor and desperate, someone fleeing violence and instability, someone hungry and in need, someone from another culture or another part of the country, someone whom we don't understand or with whom we disagree. May we remember this day that while the enemies of God can cause great suffering, they never have the last word. May we remember to reach out in love to those displaced by the fearful and selfish actions of others, those stumbling and fumbling in the darkness, trying to find their way. And may we remember to turn toward our own hardened hearts with kindness and to our surprising world with curiosity. Christ has been born. The promise has been fulfilled. But this new life is now, as it was then, imperiled. And we are called to do our part to protect it, proclaiming the loving, liberating, and life-giving grace of God that it reveals. Amen.
I would invite those in church this morning to stand as you're able. And let us all reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate in the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God of truth, we thank you for the world and the church.
Walk with us as we live into the fullness of your love.
Inspire with your wisdom those whose decisions affect the lives of others.
Let all we have be encouraged.
Make us willing agents of your compassion.
Strengthen us as we share in making people whole.
Give grace to all whose lives are linked with ours.
May we serve Christ and one another in the love as he loves us.
We praise you for all your saints who have entered your eternal glory.
May their example inspire and encourage us.
We pray for this community and our particular joys and concerns. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for Provence de l'Église Anglicane du Congo. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for Epiphany St. Carlos. We pray in thanksgiving for our parish school, Ventana. We pray for those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, and those in any trouble. Gloria Wing, Jackie, Jean, Rick, Azure, Naya, Seraphine, Jen Berry, Dick Quigley, Tom Forsheimer, John, Ian, Cheryl Matthews, Lisa Kabuligan, Anna, Kristen, Dennis, Gila Marso, John, Carolyn, Gavin Craig, Frank Hestand, Carol Cotting, Lizzie Hewitt, Derek, Jennifer, Warren Phillips, Leah Rayliano, and the Escalada family. We pray for the safety of healthcare providers everywhere, especially Carrie Carlisle, Connie Hestand, and Alex Hawkins. We pray for all those affected by COVID-19 and all those who struggle with anxiety, depression, and isolation. We pray for those who have entered eternal life and for those who mourn them, especially Chris Halverson, Helen Connolly, Brenda Escalada, Bill Carpenter, Jesse, and Archbishop Desmond Tutu. We give thanks for answered prayers. I now invite your own prayers of intercession or thanksgiving, either spoken aloud or in the silence of your own heart.
We give thanks for the upcoming marriage of Alice and Peter.
Blessed are you, God of growth and discovery. Yours is the inspiration that has altered and changed our lives. Yours is the power that has brought us to new dangers and opportunities. Set us, your new creation, to walk through this new world, watching and learning, loving and trusting, until your kingdom comes. Let us confess our sins that we may receive God's grace. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, in the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. I invite those on Zoom who temporarily, at least, unmute themselves. We need that. Please rise. Lord be always with you.
Everybody.
And also peace be with you.
Peace, everyone.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, David.
Well, good morning, everyone. Just note that time change, and again, we'll send out another newsletter with the links and the bulletin and all of that. Also, please mark your calendars. Our annual meeting is coming up. That will be on the last Sunday of January, the 30th. We will also not be eating together for that as we would in normal years, but we will hold it as a hybrid annual meeting here in the church, so you can join either in person or remotely, and we'll get more information about that in the newsletter as well. Finally, we've also decided to hold coffee hour only outside. We had been doing it a little bit in the narthex, but moving forward, it will either be held immediately outside the church or in the upper piazza, depending on the week. But we're just mindful that it's a little bit more complicated right now, and hopefully we'll be able to do some of those things again soon. But for now, we'll do it all outside. Are there any other announcements for the good of the parish? Yeah. Upper Piazza. Oh, okay. My apologies. It'll be on the Upper Piazza since it's not raining today and nice and sunny. Thank you. Oh, also, Happy New Year, everyone. It's wonderful to be together on this first Sunday in 2022.
So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and good and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit was made perfect man in the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from bondage, from the bondage of sin, and receive power to become your children. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate in the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. We offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in harmony under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. God for the people of God, holy food for holy people. This is God's table. All are welcome.
Let us pray. In union, O Lord, with your faithful people at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer to you praise and thanksgiving. We remember your death, Lord Christ. We proclaim your resurrection. We await your coming in glory. Since we cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. Cleanse and strengthen us with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let us never be separated from you. May we live in you and you in us, in this life and in the life to come. Amen.
Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen. Bread of heaven. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And as we enter this new year of hope and faith, may God bless you with discomfort and easy answers, half-truths and superficial relationships, so that you may learn to live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger and oppression and injustice, oppression, and the exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, reconciliation, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer pain, rejection, starvation, disease, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and to turn their pain into joy. May God bless you with just enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world, so that you can indeed do what others claim cannot be done. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this fine day and forevermore.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia.